you, Christine. I remember that we began the early years of the previous decade as two finance ministers of our respective countries. We've both been in consulting, so we had a lot to talk about. And what I talked about then and what I talk about now is not materially different, except that the pace of change has grown. And the main thing that you all understand, you wouldn't be here if you didn't, is that the future belongs to those who innovate. For better or for worse, you have to innovate. If you don't innovate, you flounder. You first will step back and ultimately will disappear. That is happening at an enormous rate today. The first slide I want to show you over there is this. These are the 10 largest companies in 2006, and then look at them 10 years later. In 2006, 5 energy companies were in the list, and 1 IT, Microsoft. A mere blink of an eye. Later, it's reversed. 5 IT companies are on the list, and 1 energy company is left. Exxon, it went from number 1 in 2006, it's now number 5. New wealth is being created by innovation at a tremendous rate. There is, of course, an added fact there that a lot of wealth is being created by a lot of fewer people, which presents policy problems to people like us who earn their living from the voters and not from shareholders. It's a great problem. It will be perhaps one of the most dramatic problems that we will face in the juncture between politics and business. Huge. But the main point that I want to drive here is this. Innovation is changing our world at an ever-expanding rate. And what this means is that the ones who are taking the lead are those who can innovate. So in Israel, we have 3 industries that I'd like to talk about very quickly. No, we'll talk about that later. 3 industries that have emerged. The first one is cyber. Can you show the cyber conference in Beersheba? I'm trying to say, yeah. We have built, we've taken our NSA, which is the second largest NSA. I don't know if you just heard what I just said. It is the second largest NSA. Not in relative terms. We're a country of 8 million. The United States is 42 times the size of Israel. The American NSA is not 42 times the size of Israel's NSA. It's not even 10 times the size. It's bigger than the other services. This is sunk cost. We have to put it in to survive. But we then decided, I decided, that what we'll do is we'll leverage it. So we have put it smack in the center of Ben-Gurion University in the Negev, built the rail lines that lead from Tel Aviv, and built the cyber park. You see that at the bottom of the screen, which is are the various, the leading cybersecurity companies in the world that have come to Beersheba in the Negev. So we now have academia, military, and industry within walking distance. And the only thing that I do is encourage, aside from putting in the infrastructure money for these brains, young brains, what we're doing is, of course, trying not to regulate them so that this business can grow. Believe me, that's a big challenge. Here's what has happened. Can you show it? No, no. Not that. Show the cybersecurity. Yeah, that's the growth of investment in Israeli cybersecurity. Right now, we have hundreds and hundreds of startups on this. It affects some of what Christine Lagarde was talking about. It is now roughly 20% of the global private investments in cybersecurity. Given that we are about 0.1% to 1% of the world's population, and we punch above our weight roughly 200 times. Innovation changes the world. This industry is critical to every one of you and to everyone outside this room. We have chosen to take our sunk costs and bake an industry on it. I was recently with Malcolm Forbes in Beersheba. I showed him this tremendous change. And I saw there a young person. And he looked familiar, and I said, well, I think I know you. He said, well, Prime Minister, a few years ago, it must be 26, he says, I was your NSA briefer. And I said, what do you do now? He said, what do I do now? Now, I'm rich. So he's part of those startups. you know. And so this has a double whammy. Obviously, it's important for national security and for industry security, but it's a tremendous opportunity for growth. This is example one. Example two, how the world is changing. Can you show us the automotive industry? Here's an example of what we did nothing to get. Israel, a few decades ago, when I was a young officer in the Army, we tried to have a car industry. We tried to build our own car out of fiberglass, believe it or not. We couldn't compete on the engines, on the chassis, on anything, on the tires, okay? So it collapsed. Now we have a car industry, because 85% of the value of a car will soon be software. It's basically a computer on wheels. Now we can compete. So we have a car industry. And you recognize some of these names. Waze, do you use Waze? Waze for a crowd navigation system. That's an Israeli company that was sold to Google for nothing, $1 billion. But there's also Mobileye that was sold to Intel for autonomous vehicles. The interesting thing is not that they paid $15 billion for it last year. Not too much, I think too little. Okay, well, markets aside that. But the interesting thing is that they gave them the keys to their 30 businesses of autonomous vehicles around the world and said, here, you run it. Here's another interesting number, 500 tech companies and 4,000 entrepreneurs just in this field have cropped up, and 250 research groups are in Israel, including perhaps some companies that are represented here. They spend about $3 to $4 billion a year in the Israeli car industry, as I call it now. A new industry out of nothing. The only thing we did is we didn't do anything on that one. We didn't put in our cybersecurity money. We just created a friendly business environment. I'll talk about that in a minute. Third example is not here on the graph, but it is another huge industry. Everybody needs cyber. Everybody needs to move around. I think the car industry will change. You're going to see capsules, and you're going to see, you know, the idea that you spend an enormous amount of money, and I know there are car companies here, so please don't boo me. But it's just not going to be sustainable to spend so much money on this prestige items, branding, you know, for something that 95% of the time sits, it's a piece of machinery that sits and does nothing. That's going to change. So we're leading that. We're in the leadership of that change, and I think it pays for all the car companies to be deeply involved in Israel. If you're there, if you're not there, you should be. And if you're there, do more for yours. Third interest, where we're actually doing something, is in digital health. His matchroom in Estonia, except ours, is bigger. And it covers 98% of the population. We have about 8 million people in it. It's a very variegated base, because Jews have come from many, many lands. What we're doing is we're taking, every Israeli citizen has a medical card that has the medical records of the last 20 years. So if you go to an Israeli hospital, you just put it in, and people know, you know, what your record has been, your blood pressure, major disease. We are investing in that, taking a subset of 100,000 people and taking a genetic composition, test of their genetic composition. And we're taking a subset of that, putting them on the treadmill with sensors, so we have a three-layer database, general medical, genetic, physiological response. And this database, we think we can give us breakthroughs in preventive medicine, disease identification, personalized medicine, you name it. I'm not sure that it'll work, but I've decided to put money of the government in this, several hundred million dollars, to have this database, because I think it can produce the third great industry. Actually, the biggest industry in my opinion. Biggest. Bigger than cyber, bigger than vehicles, and there are probably several more. We're looking into all questions of quantum computing, molecular biology, everything that you know. We have to be constantly there. So here's my message. The future belongs to those who innovate. The innovation is coming from the juncture of big data, artificial intelligence, and connectivity. This is creating new industries, and we are seizing the future very rapidly. There is one condition. Over 300 multinational R&D centers are in Israel, some of them represented in this room. If you're not, I honestly think that it's in our common interest that you should be. But here's the main point. My job, first as Prime Minister four times and Finance Minister as well, is to make it easy for you to come in